Hello everyone and welcome back to Search Engine Optimization Online. I'm your instructor, Victor Campos. So on week two, I've got some new documents for you in Blackboard. I've got the client marketing strategy and the Campos SEO webmaster tools. So let's get into it. The first document we'll look at is the client marketing strategy. This is a Word document like the one I gave from last week. The company profile. So let's take a look at what this document is and explain what you do with it. Once again, there's no need to fill this in and turn it in. You don't get a grade on this. So you'll fill in your company name and your name, and I'm working on Victor's Bakery, my name, and then the date that you are working on this so that you can perhaps evolve your strategy as time goes on. The purpose of this document then is to answer several questions about your company and the direction you want it to take online, the marketing direction. There are so many examples of clients coming to my company and simply asking, how much does it cost to do SEO? Or how much does it cost? How much do you charge for a website? Well, that's always an open-ended answer because of so many factors such as the size of the company, the budget of the company, the purpose of the company, their goal. So based on a document like this, we are then able to figure out much better what can my company do for their company regarding search engine optimization. So if I were being hired by a client to run their SEO campaign or social media and such, we would need to know as much as possible about that company in order to do a good job. So here's some questions we would ask them. What do you want to accomplish? You have a presence online for a reason. Are you trying to sell something? Are you trying to build awareness? Are you artistic and want people to appreciate your work? Do you have a group you belong to that needs more members? And so you would write about what you wish to accomplish online in your online presence, which includes your website, social media, anything you've got online, your shopping cart, whatever online presence you have. The example is Vic.co wishes to create a powerful social media presence because we want to interact with existing customers and through word of mouth reach new customers. We want to connect with people on Instagram in a visual way. So that fictional company, then that's what they're trying to accomplish. Victor's Bakery. We wish to sell the best homemade like baked goods throughout San Diego. To some degree, this is like the mission statement. You can think about it in those terms. Just from a slightly different angle. In general, this could have easily have been much simpler to sell products. But what I'm trying to say here is we've got the keyword of homemade, San Diego. We want to spread the word that great quality doesn't cost an arm and a leg. So we're going to show that our products are affordable and tasty and good alternatives. We sell great, healthy alternatives to the usual mass-produced fare. I might not have every idea at the moment to write down, but I can add to this document as time goes on. And this is all to get me to think about keywords. What are the keywords that I will add to my site, that I will use on social media and the like? So I'll remove that. Next, who is your target audience? It's important to focus on a target audience. It's nice to say that everyone would be interested in your product, but it just isn't true in the real world. Who are the people that would most like to know about your product? For example, their age range, gender, economic group, music style, etc. In short, who would care about your product? In essence, we are creating a persona for a potential client. Example: the people who want to hire Vic.co are people that are trendy but know what they want. They are people that are in their 30s who are successful, own their own company, need a website, and know the value of web design. So that example that I have there is a very dense, compact example. I'm trying to create a person. I'm inventing a person. This is a persona. In the world of marketing, not just web marketing, this is a very important thing to do. Who is going to care about your product or brand or nonprofit organization or your music band or whatever you've got going on online? Who's going to care? And it'd be great to say everyone's going to want my product. But it's just not true. No, everyone doesn't want a hamburger. No, everyone doesn't want a hamburger from a big, stodgy old company. People want a very specific kind of hamburger, and if I sell that hamburger, that's my audience. So for this example that I've got here, if I'm a web design company, I want to make websites, and I could make websites for any person or organization throughout the world. I have the education and the skills to do so. But here I'm saying that what I would like to do is focus on people that are trendy and know what they want. They follow the trends of design and know what they like in the trends. I want to target the age range of 30-year-olds. I could easily build a website for any age range, but I want to focus on this age range perhaps because I identify with that age range, and therefore I could create a better product for them. Those people should also own their own company, understand that they need a website, because believe it or not, a lot of people still don't believe they need a website. And very importantly here, understand the value of a good website. And I mean that figuratively and literally. Figuratively, in that a good-looking website attracts customers, retains customers, and is functional. But also, a good website costs money. Whenever you see those ads about build your own website for $250, run away from that. That is an introductory price that's bait and switch, because you're not going to get the full effect at $250. Yes, you may get a great functional, nice-looking website, but SEO is not included. Keyword research is not included. Social media marketing is not included. All of those prices add up. So it's much more feasible, it's much more realistic that you're going to be paying $3,000 and up for a website, really more in the range of $4,000 to $6,000. And unfortunately, people don't believe that. People look at their phone, for example, or their tablet or laptop and say, yes, that was worth $400. Yes, that laptop was worth $700. Yes, my brand new phone was worth $600. It's full of technology and metal and glass and microchips and such. It's worth it. But your website is also worth hundreds, if not thousands of dollars, because it is your calling card. It is your business card. It is your shopping cart. It is your online presence. It is your best foot forward. It's your only chance to make your first impression. And if it's not functional, if it doesn't work like your customers expect, like they've seen other websites all their lives, if it doesn't feature aspects that make them buy a product easily, if it doesn't work properly, it's not a good website and it's not worth that. So if we can define a person that would be most interested in buying our product or hiring us, we can then market to that audience a lot easier. For Victor's Bakery, Victor's Bakery wishes to target the age ranges of 30 to 50-year-old consumers who are passionate about healthy ingredients, who are passionate about putting healthy ingredients on the table, on the family table. We will target married folks who have children and that value their health. They understand that good, clean ingredients lead to great products. And yes, I sometimes have to break this down into these sort of sterile terms of products and brand and consumer. And that's fine, but if you're not comfortable saying that, it's perfectly fine to say customer or, you know, person or our cookies. So I'm going to try to target this demographic when I use social media, if I write blogs and so forth. I will create content that will appeal to this audience. That's not to say that a 21-year-old is forbidden from buying our product, or a 75-year-old without any kids. We're not saying that at all. Anyone can buy our product, but if we focus, we should have an easier time to reach the audience that really cares and will buy. Aspirational competition. It's good to have role models, both in life and in business. Is there a business you see that makes you think, I want to be like that? Or a business that makes you think, I want to do that, but better? List a company, person, brand, etc. that you feel is in competition with you, but that you would like to emulate. Why do you want to emulate them? Vic.co feels that XY Designs is our aspirational competition because they are well known in the field of web design and their style is unique and modern. They use Pinterest expertly. Anecdotally, I can say that within my company, PMDinteractive.com, this is something we ask a potential client early on because we need to know who else are we up against. If you hire us to run social media for you, to SEO optimize your site for you, to build you a website, who else are we up against? Is there some sort of juggernaut in the industry that we're going to have a hard time competing against? On a more positive level, who else is in the business that is doing it well that can guide us to do something like them, but better? Not that we're going to steal their ideas or their marketing strategies and such, but we need to see what they're doing. We need to do a little bit of reconnaissance of the competition, competitor analysis. We've talked about that in week one. So oftentimes we get people that want to hire us and we start asking them this, who is your aspirational competition? Who else is in this industry? And one person told us, well, this other restaurant is who we really kind of look up to. They sell a different kind of food. We're a Mexican food shop, but they're a hamburger shop. But we look up to them because of how successful they are and what they do. So it's perfectly fine that your aspirational competition is not exactly the same product that you're trying to sell. For example, a Mexican food restaurant can have the aspirational competition of a burger joint. That's fine. Direct competition is important to look at, but ancillary competition is also useful. Victor's Bakery's main competition is Hilda's Bakery. They are well established in the community. They've been at their location for 20 years. They're the only name in the game in that vicinity. Okay, writing that helps us think that we will target the clientele that visits that bakery by creating our own versions of classic Mexican pan dulce, sweet bread. We will engage in Facebook marketing. Perhaps by understanding who visits that bakery, we can then think about getting on a social network where that target audience may be more prevalent. Vision statement. A mission statement tells the world where you stand. A vision statement tells the world where you're going. Write a statement that makes predictions about what you want to accomplish as a company or brand. You may set a time horizon, 5 years, for example. Vic.co will be known for providing eye-catching web design for San Diego's most elegant restaurants. So here's our goal. Here's another way to talk about what is the goal of our company. We've already said mission statement. Mission statement tells you where you are right now. Vision statement makes a prediction of where you want to be. So if you've got this goal, it will help you move toward it. If you have a time horizon, some sort of time limit for yourself, that could be helpful. Victor's Bakery wishes to be synonymous with a new twist on a classic pan. I'm sort of here thinking also of other slogans or taglines. Now, pan, that's bread in Spanish. It may be too esoteric then, so thinking a little bit more, a new twist on a classic treat. Within 5 years, we will have articles written about us, about our wholesome ingredients, and the love and care we bake into all our products. We will be the destination boutique bakery in the heart of Chula Vista. Lofty goals, and that's what we all need as business owners. We have a lot of competition. I'm not going to be the only bakery in town. I'm not going to be the only Mexican bakery in town. Perhaps I might be the only Mexican bakery in town with a focus on organic ingredients and vegan alternatives that might help me stand out. But oftentimes there's a lot of competition in every space. Giving yourself a goal like this will help you then and motivate you to be the best. We then get to the USP, unique selling proposition. What do you provide your customers that no one else can? What makes you stand out from the rest? How do you uniquely solve their problems? Answer the question of why. That is, why would a client hire you? Vic.co is based in San Diego, and many of our team graduated from Southwestern College, San Diego State University, and UCSD. We therefore know the local culture. We can create compelling websites that cater to San Diego companies. This is one of the hardest things to answer. This question of why. Why would someone hire you as opposed to someone else? Why would someone go to my bakery when they can go to Hilda's? Why? Now, there could be simple answers like convenience. This. My business is closer to the population centers. But that's only going to get you so far. You're going to need to break out of that niche of a location. If you're in a location, you're going to need to reach a bigger audience. And the way you do that is by showing the audience, here is something that we provide that the others don't, so hire us. And I think the best way to illustrate this is with a little drawing. I'm going to draw here a picture, and this is a variation of Simon Sinek's Golden Circles. You can look up Simon's work online and find a variety of content of his. He's got a couple of books, several videos online for free. But he talks about also the concept of why. Why does a company succeed? Why do people flock behind a brand or a leader? And we can illustrate it here with some circles. So I'm going to draw some circles, some concentric circles. There's the biggest outer circle, a smaller inner circle, and then the smallest innermost circle. Each one of these is then defined by a keyword. The outermost circle is what? The next circle is how? And the smallest circle is why? What do you do? How do you do it? Why do you do it? So, Victor's Bakery. What do? We're a bakery. We sell baked goods. Well, you and everyone else in the city. You are a needle in a haystack when you answer that what, because there's competition. There's always competition, unfortunately, in every industry. How do you provide the best product? How do you do it? Our how is that we use only organic, locally sourced ingredients. Okay, that's narrowing me down a little bit more in uniqueness. Organic ingredients are becoming more and more popular in the last 15 years, so that's not as niche as it used to be. That helps me, though, that the ingredients themselves are getting less expensive, and that then trickles down to the consumer that the products are less expensive. So our how, perhaps, is a good differentiator from other local bakeries that they still use, perhaps, lard instead of a more body-friendly agave syrup. The why, then, why am I a bakery? Why do I sell baked goods? That's the hardest one to answer, and I could easily say, to make money. And that's a perfectly fine answer. To sell my product, that's perfectly fine. That's not really going to resonate with people. Why does Victor's Bakery exist? Well, my grandfather was an expert baker, and he really inspired in me a passion to enjoy life's pleasures in the kitchen. And so I want to pass on his memory for great baked goods in the modern world with a focus on health. So all that I've said there, which I'll write down in a moment, is used for me to find that target audience. I want to find the people that have that special relationship with their grandparents. I want to find the people that care about good ingredients. I want to find the people that are like me, that are like my business goals, my why I'm in the business. So what does your company do? How does it do it? Why does it do it? The golden circles. That's our unique selling proposition. What makes us unique from the rest? We started our business to honor the memory of our grandfather, who was an expert baker, a wise man, and a giver. We want to give back to San Diego by always adhering to high standards, using only the best organic ingredients, and bringing the best to each family, one cupcake at a time. The words that I'm writing here I can include them on my about page, on the home page. I can include them anywhere on my online presence. I could tweet some of these things. I could put some of these things on Facebook. Use some of these quotes in an Instagram post. Because then I'm putting out these keywords that will resonate with a target audience who will then be interested, hopefully, in our product because we're speaking their language, what they care about. So the purpose then of this document is to help you plan a strategy to market your business. All of these phrases and keywords and concepts will be used throughout the rest of the course on your site. You may not have great things to write at this moment for every one of these items, and that's okay. You can add to it as time goes on. You can get other interested parties in your business to contribute. What I say about that, though, is be careful, because if you give people the option to give an opinion, they will give an opinion. And by that I mean that if there are two other people and yourself who have access to this document, you're going to get three opinions. But are three people the one that make the decisions, the final decisions, especially when it comes to money and implementation of strategies? So only really get those that have a direct influence or an impact on the business and can make decisions to contribute to some of these documents. It's going to work out in the long term because there'll be less cooks in the kitchen. Come back on the next video and we will keep expanding on our tactics for search engine optimization.